blessings to the Muslims and to our non-Muslim guests. We're very thankful to God Almighty for your presence here on a Saturday evening when you had options and Allah chose you to be here. God Almighty has made a decision for you to be here. Very important to understand that. And inshallah, if it's the will of God Almighty, we will explain that in detail. That sometimes, and quite frankly, oftentimes, we feel as though we'll make a decision and we're doing things on our own volition, not realizing that the one who is in charge of the electrical impulses that makes our heart beat and in fact live is the one who is making these decisions. So right away, we want to understand who we are as human beings, as creations of God Almighty. And for that, we're very thankful. We just were honored to listen to the authentic words of God Almighty. And do not be turned off or discouraged that you don't understand what was just recited. Know for a fact that those were the words of the one who created you, and they have not been tampered with, and they have been sent down, transmitted in authentic nature from God Almighty to his last messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that same God Almighty is the one who has sent down revelations before to Moses and to Jesus and to David. And we find those in the scripture, in the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's the same God. And again, if it's the permission of God Almighty, we will understand that. But I want you to know you have just listened to the authentic, unadulterated words of your Creator. So welcome to our masjid. Bismillah. In the name of Allah, Alhamdulillah, we praise Him and we thank Him for everything that we have, everything that we enjoy. We understand and bear witness that He is our Lord. And in Islam, when we say Lord, we don't use this word casually. Lord is the one who is not only in charge of all of our affairs, and indeed all of the affairs of this community, this city, this country, this world, and the universe. Reflect on this. When we say God Almighty is the Lord, in Islam, that means that He is in charge absolutely by himself of all of the affairs in the earth, the heavens, and everything in between by himself with absolute power, absolute perfection. And one step further, he's not only in charge, he is cherishing and nurturing all of those things simultaneously. So right away you can see your mind cannot grasp that. These are logical facts. When we look into our lives and think about with our limitations, how many things can we handle simultaneously with any amount of perfection? And then at the same time, we're managing or controlling these things, do so and be nurturing them at the same time. You'll quickly understand that's not possible, the mind can't comprehend it. You're getting a little taste as to what we mean when we say God Almighty. So we welcome you to the masjid. This is the place where we come to worship Allah. This is the place where we come to spread salams, the greetings of peace. This is the place where we come where our hearts are softened, where we come and throw our hearts, selves, before that one we just spoke about, at his mercy. And we not only show our love and appreciation for him, but we ask and beg him to forgive us of our shortcomings, things we may have said that he was not pleased with, things we may have done that he was not pleased with. This is one of the many reasons we come here. If you notice, there's no chairs. I was explaining that as Muslims, our way of life, if you will, from the smallest things to the more complicated things, all are directed towards the heart being humble and softened. We sit on the floor, and right away the act of sitting itself humbles you. You're more relaxed. The heart is open to receive guidance when you're sitting. If you've noticed, if you find yourself angry or upset, and you just sit down, maybe not even on the floor, just sit down on a chair, already you're more calm and more relaxed. This is the place where we come to discuss verses from the Quran, where we'll take ourselves on a journey, where we read about the story or the stories of the great prophets, Noah, Moses, Abraham, Jesus, Muhammad, peace and blessings upon all of them. And we read about their stories, not for entertainment, but for encouragement. Perhaps we are living in a life where we find ourselves discouraged, lacking patience, lacking the discipline, lacking the strength to go on in our daily activities. And we read these stories and draw strength from them. This is the place where we do that. We call it the masjid. We welcome you here. And we give thanks for Allah, God Almighty, for allowing us to be here. This lecture, as I describe it, is the intro to the introduction to Islam. That there are some basic things that if we understand them, it will allow us to understand the basic tenets of Islam. I'll give you an example. We talked about a few minutes ago. Sometimes people want to ask, well, why do Muslim women have to cover their head? Or why don't you drink alcohol? Or why do you have to pray five times a day? These are introductory things, but are best understood when we understand, for example, who Allah is. Let's start with the basics. Who is God Almighty? And when we have, what's our purpose for being here? Do we acknowledge that we didn't just spontaneously erupt into existence? Are we in agreement that at some point in time, we did not exist? For those of us who have children, and you don't have to have children to understand this, but we didn't just spontaneously come into existence. So regardless of your religion, logically, you should understand that there was something that brought you into existence. We know that and understand that to be Allah, the one and only, the creator, the one who has no partner and no one is co-equal to him. And so understanding him and these basic things, what's our purpose for breathing? Why are we here? Are we here to have a job only to pay bills? Only to buy cars and homes, only to have children and enjoy their comfort and tenderness, only? Why are we here? 1 hour of physical anatomy will let you know why on earth would such a complex unit of billions of atoms and cells working in unison to create a human being. Why would such a complex, perfect thing, creation, be brought into existence without a purpose? When we have vehicles and air transport, and in fact, indeed, all things being created or being brought into existence or manipulated with resources that have a purpose. This has a purpose. And it can't speak nor hear, but it has a purpose. So indeed, when logically we should say that this unit, the body that's pumping alive, that has emotions, that can feel, that can think and produce great things, certainly must have a purpose. And so when we want to discuss these things in the context of Islam, in the hopes that Islam will be better appreciated, and so something happened today that caused me to reflect a little bit, and I hope we can begin with some reflection ourselves. We talked a little bit already about some of the prophets. You may know them from your books. You may have heard of them. Moses, Jesus, Solomon, peace and blessings be on all of them. They have a lot in common. What they all have in common, the most important thing they have in common, we'll discuss in just a few minutes, inshallah. But what they all have in common that I want to highlight right now is being around them, those people who were around them when they were here, and those of us who read and study about them in their absence produces something. It produces love for the Creator. It's not possible to read about the story of Job, for example, regardless of what your faith is, and not feel motivated, not feel encouraged, not feel a sense of strength and patience. It's not possible to read and understand the story of Jesus and not feel a connection to God Almighty, not feel merciful in your heart. Not possible to have read the story of the mother of Moses when she cast him away, only for him to be received and raised in the mansion of his enemy, and follow the story and see what happened to him and how he ultimately triumphed. It's not possible to read and reflect on those stories without feeling a sense of strength, courage, and reverence. And we're reading about it. Imagine what it was like to actually be in their company. This is a sign for us if we're thinking. This is Islam. This is a little taste of what Islam is, because it gets to the very nature. Now, like all religions, we believe our religion is the best way and the only way to paradise. But before we even get to that also, I want you to imagine one thing before I give you your homework assignment. Imagine you're going and traveling and you come to a fork in the road. One is going to the left, one is going to the right. And obviously, Let's say, for example, one is going to the hellfire, going to the wrong way, etc. And one is going to paradise, heaven, the right way. What would you need? What person or what criteria would you need at that fork in the road to convince you of which way to go? Do you understand what I'm asking you? So if there was a person there at the fork in the road who says, I know which way to go, I'm telling you right now, it's the best way to go is to the right way. What criteria would he need or she need to convince you to go that way? For example, you would need to, I would hope, you would need and want to know that that person is someone who is trustworthy. You would want to know that that person has your best interests at heart. If it's a thing, you'd want to know that that thing is perfect in nature. You would want to, almost like a DEA agent, you would want to make sure you went through from A to Z to make sure that there are no holes in that criteria, whether it's a person, whether it's a book, whether it's anything. And we profess to you that Allah Himself, God Almighty, in His words, is that criteria, has always been that criteria. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings be upon him, and all of the prophets and messengers are that criteria or manifestations of that. So that what we're inviting you to is nothing to follow blindly. The Quran is, as we said at the onset, the exact word of God. There are no errors in the book. There are no contradictions in it. The life of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, has been recorded. His life has been recorded in the most minute of details. Everything we discussed today, research it for yourself. So these are the authentic criteria for which we say this is the right way, and we don't, and it is not for us to say follow anything blindly. In fact, we invite questions, we invite study, and knowing that it's not even our study that makes a person a Muslim, it's God Almighty. And that makes sense too if you use logic, because if we had control over anything, then we would never have a bad day. If we had control over our fate and what happens to us, we would never have a bad day or bad feelings or bad outcomes. So again, this is another example to be convinced that the one who created you is the one who is in absolute control. So before we're going to get started now, and forgive me, I just wanted to have that as an introduction, but here are two homework assignments. Number one, when you get home, go onto Google and just type in the most influential man in history. Go to google.com and type in the most influential man in human history and see what you come up with. And take it a step further and see why that person said or selected who he selected. And secondly, reflect on your life, and more importantly, reflect on death. And that may seem a little bit unusual or uncomfortable. Excuse me. But just do it. Understand that we're not all going to live forever. We understand that intuitively, but how we don't often take time to think about our death. And think about it again in the context that we said how healthy we are and how symmetrical we've been created and how perfect our nature is and how this body can feel and sadness and warmth and happiness. And just imagine that one day it's going to escape us. We're going to be weak. If we're cute, we're not going to be cute anymore. If we're strong, we're not going to be strong anymore. We can use the bathroom with ease now. That won't always be the case. And just reflect on that and just see how that should make you feel and embrace it. Okay, inshallah, we'll get started. As I said, this is the introduction to Islam, but as described, it is an intro to the intro. And we start with God Almighty. Who is Allah? You hear this name. Allah is the one and only, translated. The one and only. Meaning that there is no other like Him. So you may hear people say, for example, He's the God of hip-hop. Or He's the God of music or whatever. You may hear this word God used casually and frequently. Oh my God, or God boop, 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 or whatever. But when we say Allah, we're talking about the God. And now we understand in English what we're talking about, who we're talking about. The God. Uh-huh. So without knowing any of the details of Islam, just a human being, the nature, as Brother Jihad said, our nature is to understand God. You may not be the most religious person, and this has been discussed in many lectures, but if you find yourself, and this happens all the time, you find yourself in a life or death threatening situation, the first thing you say, oh my God, it's the nature for the human being to call on his Lord more so even than the child calls on their parents. And if you have children, you know exactly what that means. But let's see what Allah says who He is. Because this question was presented to the Messenger, peace and blessings be upon him, when he came and he was talking about Allah, preaching and calling to the oneness of Allah. And this question was answered in the 112th surah or chapter in the Noble Quran. And we have some Qurans we will distribute before we leave. And you are welcome to take one and read for yourself. So Allah says, in answering this question, say, they're asking who I am, say, Allah, He is one. That's the answer. And that could have been sufficient. He is one. No one can say they're one except Allah. And one is indivisible. He went a step further. The second verse, Allahu Samad. And this word, we can translate it in many different ways, but it means the one who is self-sufficient. Understand it like this. He is the one who all of creation is dependent upon him. All of creation is dependent upon him, and he is simultaneously independent of all creation. Who or what can have that quality? Logically, you're going to say, no one. We eat food, right? Why does the human being eat food? For sustenance, so we can stay alive. It's a mercy and a blessing from God Almighty that we actually enjoy the food. But the purpose is for our sustenance because we are weak. And God Almighty is not weak. He doesn't eat food. He doesn't need anything. He creates food. And indeed, creates everything. Again, that would have been sufficient to describe his majesty. He goes on to say, the same surah, he begets not, nor was he begotten. He does not have children, and he himself was not born. He is above these things. These acts are acts of the creation. We come back to logic. Anything that was born must die. So God Almighty can't die. That doesn't make sense because of what we said at the very beginning. He's a Rabb. He's controlling all of the affairs and simultaneously cherishing and nurturing those things. And lastly, to seal it off, he says, and there is none co-equal or comparable. They were able to do great things. And they create a following, and people begin to worship that person or that thing. And they cannot live up to these qualities here. Because anything your mind can think of, and indeed everything in existence, by definition, was created by God Almighty, the Creator, which is another one of his names and attributes. See, As-Samad is another name for God Almighty. So Islam, when we learn about who God is in this religion, this way of life, we don't use God casually, because he himself has not used his name casually. So we come to worship with knowledge. It's not a casual, superficial thing where we come on one day a week and we just offer some lazy, careless prayers with no thought, with not understanding who we're in reverence to. You understand? Imagine the President of the United States inviting you to the White House for a cup of coffee, for example. Do you think you would go there casually? First of all, you would accept the invitation. That's the first thing. You would accept the invitation. Then you would probably tell everyone you know. And certainly you would dress up. You would probably spend money you didn't have. And rest assured, when you stepped into the White House, you would be probably trembling, etc. But we're talking about the Creator of the heavens and the earth. The one who has all the power and all the majesty. So this again is a taste of who Allah is. Okay. Now, as for the message of Islam, it's summarized in two statements. Anyone wants to become a Muslim? There's no fancy ceremony or anything like that. If you've been reading, if someone has been talking to you about Islam, you know, people come to Islam in various ways. But these two statements are all is what's needed for the human being or anyone. And it doesn't matter where you're from. You don't have to be born into this religion, for example, as some religions you have to be born into them. You have to accept something that doesn't make sense. There's something, you know, spooky or whatever. Islam is simple. And these two statements will transform your life forever. And more importantly, There are many benefits in the world that these two statements will have for you. They will organize your life. They will connect you with the one who created you. And more importantly, they will align you with the great men we discussed, and indeed the great women that have lived who have embraced this statement and put you on the path, regardless of what anyone says. What are those two statements? Number one, you accept that Allah, God Almighty, the one that you understand that created everything, He is the only one worthy of your worship. And we'll talk about what we mean when we say worship. None of these words are to be taken casually. Worship in Islam is a deep meaning. And for the human being, we don't lower ourselves and our dignity to anything other than the one who created us and indeed created everything. That's the one worthy of our attention, worthy of our hearts. We don't, for example, go in a booth and confess to another human being who that human being himself is sinful. Doesn't make sense logically. Allah, God Almighty, is the only one worthy of our worship, our love. If we're going to love, we need to love the one who is the most loving, the one who created love, which is another attribute, another name of Allah, is the all-loving. If we want to fear, if we want to be afraid of something, we don't want to be afraid of another human being or the creation of another human being. It doesn't befit the human being. Huh? Remember the nature we talked about? All these molecules moving with high velocity in our bloodstream. You have no idea. With beauty, we were created in perfection and beauty. Look at all of our different various colors and intellect and skills, etc. We could go on and on just about the human body. We weren't created then, that beautiful stature, the human being, to then now go humiliate ourselves before something else other than the one who created us. And secondly, the second statement is we have to believe in our hearts that Muhammad, Prophet Muhammad, is the messenger, the last messenger and prophet of Allah. He forms the seal of all the prophets, starting with Adam. So another beauty of this way of life is that we don't distinguish. You'll find, go and study, we don't cut out one prophet and leave the others and say we're going to take this one. We understand they were all linked. They were all precious gems that Allah sent. We mentioned one of the things they had in common earlier is that those who were around them got closer to God Almighty. And those of us who, in their absence now, when we read and study, we get closer to God Almighty. You can't say that about any other human being when we study their lives. And there's been a lot of great human beings to live that lived great lives, but they don't come into comparison to these great men. And we don't distinguish between them. And when you accept Muhammad as the messenger of Allah, if, for example, you have a relationship or connection with Jesus, peace and blessings be upon him, this will not sever that relationship. It will indeed strengthen it, because it will be based upon authentic truth. And when you see what Prophet Muhammad said about Jesus, and what Jesus said about Muhammad, and when you look at their lives, you'll see the connection. So this is all that's needed to be said for a person to become Muslim. And honestly, you'll feel it in your heart before you say the words. That's what happened to me. You feel it in your heart, and then when you say the words, it's almost like a formality. Okay. Now, we all want to go to heaven, I would hope. We're living in this world, and we have treats. We have things that we enjoy. We have things in this life that we enjoy. But what have you noticed about the things in this life that we enjoy? They're what? Temporary. They don't last long. They don't last long. They're not meant to last long. They're meant to keep us along the way. But what we want is everlasting peace, love, tranquility, good speech, perfect speech, good food forever, the food, things that last forever. That's what we want. We want our loved ones to be with us. We want to be amongst our loved ones forever, forever, forever. Understand that. That's what we're talking about when we say heaven. Perfect tranquility. No more profanity. No more jealousy. No more hatred. No more rancor. No more competition for little petty things. Who can build the biggest building? Who has the best this? All this finished. That's a little taste of what we want. And we submit that Allah, God Almighty, has said that this is the way. And if you accept that God is one, you should also, again, without knowing much, that God is also just. What kind of God, if you're going to be God, you have to be just, meaning that you're fair. That you can't have one criteria for getting to paradise for one group of people, for example, and then another criteria to getting to paradise for another group of people. That's not just. The just way is that we all have the same criteria, the same chance to get back home. Allah Himself says, and whoever seeks a religion other than Islam, Islam is a word that means submission. Submission to God Almighty, the one we have been defining. So if you notice that if you think, if you've realized that definition, you'll know that the whole world is Islam. The sun doesn't decide that one day it's going to rise in the west and set in the east. The moon doesn't have its own volition and say, okay, I'm going to hang out over here a little bit. Even if you look inside your heart doesn't have the capacity to say, you know what, I've been beating for the last so many years, let me take a break. Or unless you're in a what? Pathological state. But if you're healthy, the heart does this. So this is what we're referring to when we say Islam, submission to the perfected, the perfect one. And if you think even further, we have no choice. That's when we come to the religion of Islam, is that we consciously, as a Muslim, we consciously submit ourselves to Islam. So Allah says, whoever seeks a religion other than Islam, it will never be accepted from him. And in the hereafter, he will be among the losers. Some people may have read this and feel like that's kind of harsh. But again, think logically. If you submit to anything other than the most powerful, that's just another name of God Almighty. He is the most powerful, meaning he has the power. When we see the lightning and thunder and the tornadoes and the tsunami, do you think there's another God that's manipulating and in charge of those things. And then there's another God who's in charge of the affairs of, say, for instance, China. And then there's another God who's, say, in charge of the casino industry. And then there's another God. You get my point? There would be utter confusion. There's only one God, as we established. God is one. So if you're not submitting to that one, then who are you submitting to? Something other than him. And that's a piece of the explanation of this verse. There can be no other thing to submit to, in truth, that is. We can always submit to whatever we want, but in truth. Okay. And in keeping with that verse, Allah says he does not forgive associating anything in worship with him, but he forgives what is lesser than this to whomever he pleases. Now we're getting into the mercy, which is another name of God Almighty. So we've up to maybe five names of God Almighty. So we're not saying just God loosely. We're saying God the most merciful, God the self-sufficient, God the all-powerful. So we're adding meaning to this. And the more the heart gets to understand who God Almighty is, now it becomes easy to pray. It becomes easy to forgive. It becomes easy to try through difficult times because you understand what it is we're dealing with. But here's an example of a verse from the book, the Quran, that encourages us and shows a piece of his mercy, that he will forgive anything. And all of us are sinners. No one's perfect. But he says one thing he won't forgive for. It's saying that he has a partner. We established that he's the one in charge of all the affairs. He's the one who has all the power. He's the one who has all the love. He has all the mercy. He has vision. He can see with perfect eyesight. He can hear with perfect hearing. And then someone says, there's something else that has power too. There's something else that's co-equal to him or that he won't forgive for. Not only is it not true, hopefully we've established already it's just not a true statement. It's impossible. But it's disrespectful, if you will, to do that. You wouldn't do that in your home to your parents to say, oh, your loving mother who nurtured you and your father were there doing all these things for you. Huh? And then to say, oh, I have another mother or father. And God Almighty, hopefully we have understood, is above these examples. But if you won't even do it with this lower level example, then certainly you should understand, logically again, that you shouldn't do it with the Creator. There's a Creator of the heavens and the earth, but yet there's another Creator. No, it doesn't even make sense. So he won't forgive for that, but he will forgive us for any other thing that we may have done. Now we come to what we mentioned a little earlier, worship, ibadah. Now we understand who Allah is. Now we come to worship. What does it mean to worship in Islam? We establish nothing worthy of our worship except Allah. So when we say worship in Islam, we're saying that the one we love Allah. We want him to love us. At the same time, we fear his wrath. We want to achieve his love. We love him because we look at all the good things he's done for us. He's given us food to eat. He's given us loving family. He's given us oxygen to breathe. He's given, 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 given. And so we love him for these things. And we hope for his mercy. We hope that one day, and even throughout each and every day, that he will be accepting of us, despite our shortcomings. And then we fear that if we fall short, or that his wrath will come on us. All these things together, love, the fear, and the hope, and all of our activities, all encompasses what we call worship. And this is what all the prophets called for. By the way, I didn't explain the other thing that they have in common. All the prophets, Noah, Adam, Abraham, Jesus, David, Solomon, Muhammad, they all said, there's nothing worthy of your worship except the one who created you. Follow me. Come. Don't worship stones. Don't worship women. Don't worship men. Don't worship this behavior. Don't worship this food. Don't worship your intellect. Don't worship your beauty. Don't worship this. Don't worship this. Worship the one who created worship. Worship the one who created the beauty. You get the point. So, all of this is what we call divine unity. At-tawheed. The oneness of Allah. And this, brothers and sisters and guests, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had taught his followers this for 13 years. This is how important this was. You may see Muslims going to Mecca for the pilgrimage. You may see us fasting. You may see us doing a lot of activities. But the basis, the fundamental basis of all the activities that you see a Muslim do, no matter where you find the Muslims in the world, is based on this concept, this word, Tawheed, the oneness of Allah. We're doing things only to please Him. We don't want to be showing off. We're not interested in being arrogant. We're not interested in getting fame. We're not interested in people congratulating us. We're not interested in piling up degrees and education so we can walk around. No, that's if we get those things, fine. But the main thing is that we are establishing that there is one God, and that has to be established in our life. And see how organized the life will be. See how humbled now you will become. Humble in the real sense. Not in the sense of just saying the words, oh, I'm humble. Or just making yourself. No, this will be real for you. This is one of the byproducts. This is the oneness of Allah, and it has three components. That number one, Allah is the only one that creates. We talked about this a little bit. Let's talk about it in a little bit more detail. When we say create, we mean create something from nothing. You see this computer here? You may say someone created it, but no, there was silicon, maybe some metals, maybe some plastic. There were some resources that they manipulated. And the brain that they needed and the insight, the engineers, all that intellect, if you will, itself was needed along with the material stuff was needed to bring this into existence. But when we say the creator, we mean starting from nothing and bringing it into existence. Again, logically, you should be convinced no one can do that. You understand that? You understand Tawheed. Secondly, therefore, as we mentioned, since he's the only one that can do that, therefore, along with so many other reasons, he's the only one worthy to be worshipped. And if there is something else that can do this, then we'll gladly worship that something. And again, don't let the mind wander, it's impossible. This same theme, when you pick up the Quran, please pick it up before you leave, you'll see the same theme on every page established. One God, one God, one God, one God. You listen to CNN, they may talk, they may talk, they may talk, they may talk, they may talk. And you see it all the time. This is how powerful this statement is, because no matter how much the public opinion, no matter what is said about Islam, no matter how even Muslims themselves in certain places and even here may be acting foolish, for example, doesn't matter. This is how powerful this statement is. This is how real it is. Lastly, Allah is the only one with the perfect names and attributes. We talked about this already. No one can say they're a Samad. No one can say, listen, the whole world and the universe is dependent upon me, and I simultaneously am independent of everything in the world. No one can say that but Allah. No one can say, I can hear everything. I know all of your inner thoughts. Just reflecting on these names, their heart should be softened, should have a little bit of fear, and that's natural. If you know that there's someone that knows all your inner thoughts, the bad, even the bad ones, I'm pretty sure there's someone in the world who just murdered somebody, for example, for no reason. Just maybe they're an evil person and they just went somewhere and took the precious soul of Allah. And maybe it took them a little while before they got caught by the authorities, or maybe they never got caught. And every day they don't get caught, they're allowed to wake up and have a bite to eat. What do you call that? That's mercy. You think God Almighty is happy with a human being killing another human being? You don't have to wonder and start, I wonder if Islam is promoting violence. Stop the foolishness. Just think. Do you think God Almighty, the one who provides rain from the sky that comes down to the earth and mingles with the dirt, and provides nutrients in the soil that comes up to the roots of the trees, that provides corn and apples and all kinds of fruits and vegetables for us to consume, that God Almighty, that one, do you think he is happy when he's done all of those things for our benefit so we can worship him? Do you think that one is happy with that, a person who goes out and murders anything, let alone another precious human being? Do you think he's happy with that? Of course not. But his mercy allows, that's how merciful he is. He still lets that person wake up and have a bite to eat. Right or wrong? Yes. Now imagine what that same God will do for the one who, not forget, didn't murder anybody, but is living his or her life in a nice, humble way, and doing good, and doing the opposite of murder, which is producing life, reading about the good life, reading about things in the heart that make the heart alive. When you're around that person, whether that person is a woman, or whether that person is a little child, or whether that person is a man, and that person who has dedicated their life in the service of God Almighty, and then people around them feel soft and are motivated to do good, what do you think he'll do for you? What do you think he'll do for that person? Again, you don't have to think too much. He's going to cherish them and has good reward for them. That's the nature of Islam. That's what we try to do as Muslims. And we beg Allah to help us to continue to do that. Ameen. So we can understand this, and I'm going to wrap up pretty quickly here since we started late. I want to leave time for questions. Some foundational concepts to understand what we're talking about. Number one, creation. We talked about a little bit about these already. Creation. Lordship, authority, purpose, and guidance. Let these be the concepts that you think about when you want to study about Islam, if you want to become a Muslim. Understand these things. We talked in detail about creation, and I hope it's understood now when we say creation. A creator, creation suggests a creator. Something is into existence that has been created. By definition, it must have a creator. We established that as one. We said create means starting with nothing and bringing something into existence. And again, in the Quran, you'll notice that Allah is speaking to you and all of humanity. Again, the Quran and Islam was not sent only to one group of people. It wasn't sent just for Arabs. It wasn't sent just for black folks. It wasn't sent just for white folks. It was sent for all of humanity. So reflect, has there not been over man a period of time when he was not a thing worth mentioning. Of course. There was a time we weren't here. Reflect. Allah is the creator of everything. Another verse from the Quran. Allah says, excuse me, and this is from the surah number 19, Mary, the mother of Jesus. There's a chapter dedicated in the Quran entitled Mary. Allah says, and remember when the angel said, O Mary, verily Allah, God Almighty, gives you the glad tidings of a word from him. His name will be the Messiah, Jesus, the son of Mary, held in honor in this world and in the hereafter, and will be one of those who are near to Allah. So Allah can create in different ways. So he's not establishing that he's just the creator of everything. He brings people in, he brings things and people into creation by different means. In this case, our beloved Jesus, alayhi salam, peace and blessings be upon him, was created by the word. He had no father. But this is how he came into creation. So we can reflect on that. Who else can do that? Who else can send an angel to the womb of a woman and bring into existence? In fact, who can even do it the way we were born, in terms of a sperm, millions of sperm, moving with millions of speed to an egg, and then penetrating? Just too much. It's too much. Only God Almighty can do that. And he goes on to say that Jesus will speak to the people in the cradle and in manhood, and he will be of the righteous. And she said, Mary, O my Lord, how shall I have a son when no man has touched me? He, Allah, so it will be, for Allah creates what he wills. When he decrees something, he says to it only, be, and it is. Another attribute. Who can say to something, be, and then it comes into existence? So whatever your religion is, whatever you're following, whoever it is you're worshiping, match it up and see, does it meet this criteria in terms of lordship? We talked a little about too. Allah is the one who created you, but then didn't leave that alone. He now provides food for us. Then he caused us to die. Then again, he will give us life on the day of resurrection. And now God Almighty challenges us, if we're not convinced, is there any of your so-called partners that you're worshiping that can do any of this? Glory be to God Almighty. He is exalted above all. Anything that you may associate with him, he's above it. These are some of the verses of the Quran that establishes what we've been talking about. Now, we all understand authority. We all go to work. There's always rules and regulations of things to do and not to do, we can't do. And we follow them a lot of times without question. When we go to a job, we start orientation, they give you a handbook, they say you can do this, you can't do this, you gotta check in at this time. Matter of fact, they don't even leave it there, they give you a handbook. And you have to sign that you acknowledge that you received this handbook. And of course, no one reads it, right? You just can't wait to sign and get on with it. Why? You just wanna get on with it, why? For the paycheck, there's a reward. So we understand following and the concept of following rules. But somehow when it comes to religious matters, we're like, I don't feel like I want to do that. But we want to explain what the reward is. Not only later on, pie in the sky. No, it's not just pie in the sky. There are plenty of rewards and joy in this life by being a Muslim. So say, O Allah, possessor of the kingdom, you give the kingdom to whom you will, and you take the kingdom. Able to do all things. This verse is very powerful, as all the verses are. But this one speaks to, we have leaders in the world. We have people in the world who Allah has given them lots of money and lots of power. And you think they can't be matched, they can't be marveled, but it won't last forever. The richest people on the earth are still just what? People. They're not going to escape death. They're no four-bedroom graves. Huh? They're going to the same place. Their skeleton will be in the dirt, flesh gone, worms eating them. They may have had the best of everything in this life. So God is saying, Almighty, He said, this is nothing. I'm the one I can take and humiliate. He's done it already. He does it all the time. He takes people in big positions and drops them down. He takes people from little positions and puts them up. It's nothing for Him. I'm going to wrap up in maybe 5 more minutes. Another question. Allah asks a lot of questions because He wants us to think. Again, Islam is against blind following. We don't say come to Islam and just accept what we have to say and let's just get on with it. No. They're questions so you can think, so it can be clear to you, so you can understand what it is. Does a man think he will be left aimlessly, not being given orders and prohibitions and commanded to worship Allah? Like we weren't just born to just go about and just live and talk and eat whatever we want to eat, say what we want to say sometimes and hurt people's feelings. We weren't given the gift to speak so we can use it recklessly. We will be held accountable. So this is part of the meaning here. And this is very important here. I should have been another homework assignment. But purpose. Have you ever asked yourself, and if you haven't, do it now, why am I here? Why am I here? God Almighty did not leave us astray, and He answered that for us. And again, going back to our example with the job. When you go to your job, they quickly tell you what your job description is. You don't just come to the job and just start. You have a purpose. Your purpose may be to earn a paycheck or get experience, but there's always a purpose in something. So for the purpose of existence for us, the one who created us is the one to tell us. The one who created this computer is the one who can say the purpose of this computer is to do this. Huh? They created it. Ask yourself and challenge your friends. Ask them. Why are you? They may look at you and say, man, where are you coming with this silly question for? But just ask them, what's your purpose of being alive? God Almighty says, did you think that we had created you just to play and amusement without any purpose? And that you would not be brought back to us. We're not here just to play and just joke around. And there's a purpose. We're going back to our Creator. He also says, He's saying, Allah, created not the jinn, which is a special form of creation that we cannot see, and all of mankind, except that they should establish worship for Allah. When we talked about worship, the fear, the love, and the reverence, all those things that we do. And here's the beauty of it. When we worship Allah, and we do so only to please Him, we're not doing it so somebody can say, oh, he's a religious person. You know, he's a religious person. He's a good guy. Or look at her. No, no, no. Remember, Allah sees and hears everything. So He knows what's in our hearts. But when we worship Allah with sincerity, our life changes for the better. So then we know now that's our nature. That makes sense. He created us to do this. And when we do this, watch what happens to your life. Certain things you will never know even by reading a pamphlet or by me uttering the words to you. You will only know it, and which is another blessing, when you put it into practice and you begin to see. But we do have a purpose. And be convinced that if you see even minor things in the world, ants, for example, any little thing, they all have a purpose. So you have a purpose. We have a purpose. Allah says, blessed is He in whose hand is the dominion, and He is able to do all things. He created death and life that He may test you of which is best in deed or conduct, which is another reason he created us, to see who's going to be the one who has the best conduct. Now we see this, look at this verse and compare it to the foolishness you see spread on the television. God Almighty in the Quran is saying he created us and gave us life. He causes us to die, to test us. We come across tests, right? Sometimes we get angry. Sometimes we have a lot of money in our hand. We're going to test it. Are you going to waste it? You're going to squander it? You're going to give it to the needy? Are you going to invest it? If you're poor, are you going to be thankful? Are you going to go steal or murder for it? These are all tests of conduct. Who's going to be best in conduct? And guidance. We understand the guidance. We're on our path now. We need a guide. You're a GPS. If we go from here to here, we need GPS. This is spiritual GPS. Huh? So we get our guidance from the Book of Allah, which we said is perfect. The Quran is perfect. There's no mistakes in it. The same exact Quran that was revealed and came down over 1400 years ago is the same Quran you have. There's no version. There's no such and such version. King so-and-so version of the Quran. Second, this version of Quran. No. Quran is Quran. That itself is a miracle. That should convince you. This work, this has not been changed and will never be changed. It's the greatest miracle of the Quran, of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is the book. Allah starts off the book. This is the book wherein there is no doubt a guidance to those who are God-fearing. And remember I said to that when we started at the beginning, you're coming to a fork in the road and you want to be convinced that this way is right, this way is not right. Someone gives you a book and says it's perfect. And then you read through it, you do your study, you do your research, you do whatever you want to do. Do whatever you want to do. And you're going to come back and say, wow, this book is perfect. That will convince you. And that makes sense. Because we're talking about matters of the soul. If you're going to be traveling on this earth and going through the difficult times of what it means to be a believer, understand that Jesus, peace and blessings be upon him, did not have an easy time calling people to Allah. Abraham did not have an easy time calling people to Allah. David, Solomon, none of them had an easy time calling to Allah. They were faced with challenges. How do you get through challenges? How do you get through challenges, really? Not just skate by challenges. How do you grasp a hold of the challenges and go through them with strength and come out on the other end triumphant? How do you do that? You do that with real, real certainty that what you have is the real deal. And think about that. When you have something with you that you know is undefeated and cannot be defeated, the confidence you will have. This is what we mean when we say, a part of what we mean when we say the Quran is the guidance. All the praises and thanks are due to Allah who has sent down to his slave Muhammad the book, the Quran, and has not placed in there any crookedness. There's no contradictions in the Quran. And had this book been from anything other, then of course, no one, no human being, nothing can write a book perfect. Nobody, it's not possible. I'm a writer. You may be a writer. I know when I write, I have to make edits and edits and edits and edits and it's still a mistake. It's not possible for a human being to write, to do anything perfect. So the book of Allah is perfect. So you don't have to wonder, what am I getting myself into? Just take it easy. God Almighty is perfect. And his book is perfect. And it only makes sense. That we're asking, that he would ask you to devote your whole life and being to him and then come with anything other than perfection. The second guidance is the messengership, the life of Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. God Almighty has stated and has put his stamp of approval, if you will, He says in the Quran, Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Indeed, in the messenger of Allah, you have a good example for him who hopes to meet with Allah in the last day and remembers Allah much. Too much for this talk today, but a taste of reading about Prophet Muhammad, you will see what kind of man and gentle soul he was. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his life has been profiled from the most minute things all to the great thing. And I'm going to close here soon, but over 13 assassination attempts were on his life, peace and blessings be upon him, in trying to conduct this message. Now, from what you've heard from this message so far, is there anything that you heard that would cause you to want to shoot or kill the person who came with a message like this? But yet they tried to murder him, and he came with a message like this in a much more beautiful fashion than me. And when he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, after getting all of the power now, because their numbers were very few in the beginning, and after 13 years, after some time, he had all the power in his hand. Well, not in his hands, but astaghfirullah, but you know, he had means by which he could annihilate his enemies. And what did he do? He softened his heart, and he did not retaliate against anybody when he went back to the land in which he was driven out of. Now, you contradict that with what you hear about the Muslims. When you may hear the Muslims are this in terms of aggression. Yes, the Muslims are strong indeed. We are very strong. But we're strong on these principles that we've been talking about. Okay, so now we get to a matter of life and death. One of the things that the Prophet Muhammad said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh Allah, there's no life except the life of the hereafter. We don't get caught up in this little life. We may live 60, 70 years and then it's done. To get caught up in it and bow down to it and think that's the end all be all is dangerous. And you see people get sucked into it and it always beats them. Live in this world as though you were a stranger. These are another some of his words. Wise is the one who controls his desires and prepares for the life which starts after death. And cast down is the one who lives for the love of the world and false expectations from God. Those people who think they can drink and party and drink and party and do everything they want to do and still end up in the same place as the person who controlled him or herself and prayed late into the night and forgave people and gave their little money in charity. They think that they're going to have the same fate as that one. Does it make sense? All right, at this time, one more thing. So we recap. Three verses from the Quran. And to Allah belongs the dominions of the heavens and the earth, and Allah has power over all things. Verily, in the creation of the heavens and the earth, and in alternation of night and day, there are indeed signs of men of understanding. Those who remember Allah standing, sitting, and lying down on their sides, and think deeply about the creation of the heavens and earth, saying, Our Lord, you have not created all of this without purpose. Glory to you. Exalted you are above all they associate with you as partners. Give us salvation from the torment of the fire. So Islam 101, you believe in Allah, the one true God. Perform righteous deeds that are pleasing to Him. And invite and call people to the truth. This is the summary. And at this time we have Brother Ali, if you don't mind, can you come up and just recite what we just said in English and Arabic. The whole of the religion can be summarized in these three verses. And we'll talk about it in just 1 minute here.
أعوذ أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر، إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات، وتواسوا بالحق وتواسوا بالصبر. صدق الله العظيم.
Alhamdulillah, all praises to the one true God, Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This chapter that was just recited, one of the great scholars of Islam, Imam Ash-Shafi, may Allah have mercy upon him, said, if God Almighty had sent down to his creation no other proof besides the surah that you just heard, it would have been sufficient for them. The translation, Allah is swearing by time. And we understand time is a dimension. We'll never get the time that we just spent. We'll never get it back. And indeed, we have no control over time. That's another thing to reflect on. Excuse me. Allah is swearing by time. By time. This is the translation. Indeed, all of mankind is in a state of loss, except those who truly believe and worship the one true God alone. And not only do they worship and believe in this one God, their actions reflect that. And they don't just leave it there because we're not selfish. We're not here to be selfish human beings. We invite others through our actions, through our speech, through our writings, to the truth. And doing that is the path of the true warriors, because it's hard. It's not easy. So then you do so with patience. You don't give up facing harms and trials. That's the summary of those verses. So we end with this. We thank you. We pray that Allah accept this. We pray that it was understood for the meaning for which it was meant to be understood. And we thank Allah for allowing us to complete it. And we thank everyone for coming. There's a few questions here.